at your neighbor and say, nah, ain't nothing wrong. With a little worship, you'll feel better. I'm looking at some of y'all. Y'all will even look better. In fact, let me help you. You'll even do better. Come on, tell your neighbor, with just a little worship and praise. That's the devil don't want us to worship and praise God. Amen. I'll take your song, devil, and sing it to the Lord. Oh, y'all ain't feeling me right now. Amen, amen, in Jesus' name. This is my Bible. I'm holding it in my hand. I'm hid it in my heart. That's why I'm expecting today. What about you? Because the day is my day. After I hear the word, see the word, believe the word, and do what the word tell me to do, my life ain't going to be the same. I might have came in here one way, but I'm leaving out of here another way. Because the word of God strengthens me every time I get weak. The word of God sustaining me everything I'm going through. Word of God supplying even more than I need. Because the word of God saving me right now, going to save me from now on. Because I know after hearing it, receiving it, believing it, and doing it, that my life, my circumstance, my situation, even my condition, they will never, ever, 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 I will never, 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 never will I be the same. Never will it be the same. Never the same. Never the same. Come on, get it out of your mind. Never the same. Clear it out of your heart. Never the same. Never the same in Jesus' name. You believe it and receive it. Lift your hands and thank God for it right here. Come on, right now, right now. A right now blessing always deserves a right now. A right now praise. The Lord is blessing me right here. The Lord is blessing me right now. I'm at his house and he at my house right now. I'm in Sunday. He in my Monday right now. Before I get there, God had already been there and done that. Amen. Somebody want to know what your dad is? Say, just leave it there. He done that. Amen. That what I'm believing him for, amen. That's what I'm trusting. He done that, amen. Amen. The gospel of St. John, the gospel. Baby, you know you heal. When you go back, they gonna marvel at you. LaDisha texted and called me this morning, said she was at the hospital dealing with some stuff. But look at this. She a little better than some of us because she said, I'm gonna break out of here and come to church. So they looking for her, but they ain't gonna never find her, because the last her they saw, she ain't gonna look like that going back, y'all, amen. So if ain't nobody else feeling me and LaDisha today, I ain't leaving here like I came today, amen, all right? Now you can't, amen, but come on, baby, tell them we ain't leaving here like we. Never the same, brother. John 15, chapter 16. Theme scripture. This is the third month. Still in this verse. You have not chosen me, but I chose you. You didn't choose me to praise and worship you. I chose you to praise and worship. I could have chose a rock. I could have chose, amen, a lion, a baboon, a parakeet, but I chose you. And then I anointed and appointed, ordained you so that you could go and bring forth fruit and that your fruit would remain. And whatever you will ask of the Father in my name, just ask him in my name and he'll give it to you. Come with me to the Old Testament book of Ezra. Yeah, come on, Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, Deuteronomy, Joshua, Judges, Ruth, 1 and 2 Samuel, 1 and 2 Kings, 1 and 2 Chronicles, Ezra. There it is, this guy. Come on, get those pages unstuck. You ain't never been in there as long as you had that Bible. Matthew all worn out in your Bible. Luke and John all worn. Romans, Psalms. And Ezra's page is still stuck together. Silverfish hiding out in Ezra. Come on, shake them out. Amen. Ezra 1:1. Now in the first year of Cyrus, king of Persia, that the word of the Lord by the mouth of Jeremiah might be fulfilled. Look at this, look at this. The Lord stirred up the spirit of Cyrus, king of Persia. The Lord stirred up the spirit of Cyrus, king of Persia, and that he made a proclamation throughout all of his kingdom, and he put it also in writing. Tell your neighbor, he meant this. And he said, thus says Cyrus, king of Persia, the Lord God of heaven hath given me all the kingdoms of the earth, and he hath charged me to build him a house at Jerusalem, which is in Judah. So who is there among you of all of his people, the Lord's people? Because his God be with him, and let him go up to Jerusalem, which is in Judah, and build the house of the Lord God of Israel, because he is the God which is in Jerusalem. And whosoever remaineth in any place where he sojourneth, favor is coming. Favor is coming. Favor is coming. Because the men in that place is going to help you with silver. They're going to help you with gold. They're going to help you with goods. And you don't need no beast now. You need some wheels right now. Come on, somebody need to get off them rubber heels and get you some rubber wheels right now. Okay. Come on, going to help you with beasts. Beside the free will offering for the house of God that is in Jerusalem. Look at this one more time. Look at this one more time. Verse number 1, now in the first year of Cyrus, king of Persia, so that the word of the Lord that came out of the mouth of Jeremiah might be fulfilled, the Lord stirred up the spirit of Cyrus, king of Persia. I want to talk about this morning the shift stirrer. No, because look at this. The text says that the Lord stirred up the spirit of Cyrus, which means God is a shift stirrer. Come on, take your seat while you're looking at me like that. God is a shift stirrer. Well, let me ask you this, has God ever stirred up something in your life that happened to ignite and influence favorable turnaround in things to happen in your life? If God has ever done something and the something he did, it happened to influence it. It happened to inspire favorable turnaround, favorable things in your life. Somebody knows in the house, God is what? A shifter. Come on, tell your neighbor, he's a shifter, amen. We just read it in John, amen. Jesus says that, you text me, baby, when you get back to that bed, but it's all good, amen. In John, Jesus says, look at what he said again in John, I chose you. You did not choose me. And when I chose you, I ordained you. I picked you. I positioned you. I planted you. For what? For purpose, amen. And when Jesus chose and ordained us, I'm believing us, because I know he chose me. I know he ordained me, but I'm believing he done chose and ordained you also, amen, for something, amen. Amen. He was stirring up something to happen, to ignite, favorable turnaround in things, not just in our life, but in through our life, amen. Come on, when he chose us, when he ordained us. Y'all sitting there frozen again, amen. But when he chose the date of our delivery, amen. Our birthday, he was stirring something up, amen. Come on, anybody with me? When he chose our mama and daddy, the donors, amen. The seed and the egg, talk to me, amen. He was stirring something up, amen. Come on, when he chose our DNA, ethnicity, nationality, tell your neighbor, he was stirring something up, amen. And then when he stirred, when he chose and ordained our direction in life, the plan he had for us, the purpose he has for us, the path he has for us, you ought to tell your neighbor what? He was stirring something up, amen. The Lord was stirring something up so that something could happen that would ignite, that would influence, that would inspire what? Favorable turnaround in things, not just in our life, but there ought to be some favorable things coming through our. You know why, right? Because God is a shift stirrer, amen. Preach this word, man. The Lord, amen. Look at Ezra. It says, now in the first year of Cyrus, king of Persia. Are y'all with me? That the word of the Lord by the mouth of Jeremiah might be fulfilled. The Lord stirred up. Come on, it's right there in your Bible. He stirred up the spirit of Cyrus, king of Persia. And King Cyrus wasn't even one of God's chosen folk. The way we look at God, how God chose folk. But some of y'all, if you get to heaven, you know what you're going to find out? God chose some folk you didn't thought he would think he was going to choose. And he refused some folk you did think he was going to. Grandmama told me, everybody talking about heaven, son, ain't going. Some of us going to be like Gomer Pyle when we get to heaven. Surprise, surprise. Come on, look at this. He said he stirred up the spirit of Cyrus so that the word of Jeremiah from the Lord might be fulfilled. And I don't know, because is there anybody in this house who God, when he speaks his word, or when you hear his word, or you read his word, or you just think about his word, it stir you up? Because I look at some of y'all and you never bat an eye. You never wink, you never shake, you never raise your hand. You got to be begged and pleaded with, almost threatened, James, tell him, to just say, thank you, Lord, for waking me up this morning. Thank you, Lord. I got legs to walk with. Thank you, Lord. Are y'all with? But is there anybody in the house? I said, you just hear God's word and it stirs you up. Come on, you start reading God's word and it stirs you up. Come on, you don't even have to hear it and read it. You can be driving down the street, sitting at your desk, in the shower, and you just start thinking about the word of God, and that word, come on here, somebody, it stirs you up, amen. Are y'all still with me, amen? I mean, you start laughing, and ain't nothing funny. Come on, you start crying, and ain't nothing wrong, amen. Come on, amen. You start moaning, and ain't nothing burdening you, amen. In fact, you feel like running and ain't nothing even chasing you, amen. It's just that when I hear the word, read the word, I just start thinking about the word. It does something to me that what? Stirs me up, amen. I mean, it make me want to love my enemies like they my friends. Are y'all with me? It won't let me sit up around other folk and be ashamed to tell them I've been born again. Are y'all still with me, amen? Because it makes me bless folk who curse me, pray for those who use me, amen. In fact, it make me give to others I wouldn't normally give to. Y'all ain't with me. And in fact, amen, sometimes they slap me on one cheek, but the word make me turn the other cheek, because when I hear it, I read it. I just think about it. It stirs me up. Y'all know why, right? Look at your neighbor and say, because God is a shift stirrer. Amen. I mean, when you read it, something ought to happen. When you hear the word of God, something ought to happen. Look, elbow your neighbor right now. Say, something ought to happen. Amen. All you need to do is think about the word. And something ought to start moving. Jeremiah said, it's like fire on the inside. Shut up in my bone. I wanted to sit here and hold my peace, but I couldn't keep it to myself, amen. Because when I heard it, when I read it, when I just thought about it, it stirred me. He said the word came, and it stirred him up. I don't know about you, because when I just realize, recognize, and what? Receive the word God reveals and releases to me, I can't sit frozen. I can't sit frozen. It don't matter if somebody preaching the word, if they singing the word, amen. If it's the word, I cannot sit there like, because it ought to stir you. Because when I hear it, and God reveals and releases it, it requires a response. It requires a response. You may shed a tear. It requires a response. You may wave your hand. Come on, it requires a response. You may rock from side to side. But come on, Thelma, it requires a response. You might jump up and down. Are y'all with me? Because if God reveals and releases it, it ought to stir something up that requires a response. Because the Bible says this. I didn't say this. The Bible says that as believers, no matter what our circumstance is, no matter what our situation is, come on, no matter what our condition is. Amen. That entails everything we're facing, everything we're dealing with, everything we're going through, and everything, come on, we are experiencing. As believers, we ain't talking to the other folk, we're talking to the believers. Come on, as believers, we know that, quote unquote, all things. Come on, come on. No matter what we're going through, all things. Come on, no matter what we're facing, all things. No matter what we're dealing with, all things, amen. No matter the circumstance, the situation, condition, as believers, what do we know? We know that all things are working together for the good of them that love God and to them who are the called according to his purpose. And how do we know that? We know that. We know that, Mother Bertha. You know why? Because God is a S-H-I-F-T. He's a shift stirrer. Amen. He can take good with bad. He can take right with wrong. He can take your ups and downs, your ins and outs. He can take your winning and losing. He can take folk who like you and don't like you. Are y'all with me? He can take your sunny days with your rainy days and stir it up all together and make it work out for your good. Y'all ain't felt me, amen. And that's how we know, even when it's bad, it's going to get good. Even when it hurts, it's going to get good, amen. Even when it's broke, tell your neighbor, it ain't going to stay broke, because God's got a way of what? Stirring it up to work out for your
work out for what? Your
good. That's how we know that we know. Because when we are completely confident, this is how Solomon says it's in Proverbs 3. When you're trusting in the Lord with all your heart, you're completely confident. To consistently comply, not lean to your own understanding, even when it don't look right. Even when it don't feel right. Even when it don't sound and seem right. Even when other folk try to talk me out and say, that ain't right. Consistently complying. Come on here. Amen. Not leaning to my own understanding, but in all of my ways, acknowledging him to carry out his commands. Something happens. He directs my path. When I'm what? Completely confident to consistently comply, to carry out his commands, he causes me to have what I call a kairos collision. And in Kairos, you either run into God or God run into you. But either way, if he running to you or you running to him, when y'all running to each other, tell your neighbor something is going to happen that's going to ignite a favorable turnaround. Going to ignite, y'all ain't shouting with me yet. Favorable things to what? Happen in your... Tell your neighbor, you just need to run into God. Or get in the way and let God run into... Come on, tell your neighbor, get in the way, get in the way. Ezra says it was what? In the first year. Y'all working me hard. Y'all do know I got to go over the river and preach this morning, so I got to save a little energy for the folk over there. Yeah, they be looking for me over there. But in the first year of Cyrus, king of Persia, so that the word of the Lord by the mouth that came out of the mouth of Jeremiah might be fulfilled, the Lord did what? He stirred up the spirit of Cyrus. My question is, what did the Lord say to Jeremiah and through Jeremiah that stirred Cyrus up? Because he had to say something. And the only way he could say something to Cyrus for the Lord had to say something to Jeremiah from the Lord. And I know y'all want to gloss over it and get up out of here and all that, but I'm wondering, amen, what could have Jeremiah said that caused Cyrus, who was a non-Jew, not in the lineage and generation of God's chosen people, but it stirred him up to do something in the name of the Lord? Look at your neighbor and say, it had to be something. It had to. Come on, let's look at this something. Come with me to Jeremiah chapter 25. Come on, we got to roll. Write it down. Look it up. Jeremiah 25, starting in verse 8. Therefore, thus saith the Lord of hosts. That's what he said that stirred the brother up. Because you have not heard my word. You might have been sitting in church, but you didn't hear what I was saying to you. Oh, yeah, you had your Bible open, turning pages, coloring lines and all that stuff, but you wasn't feeling it. You was making that confession about believing, receiving, and going to do it and all that, but your mind was on chicken wings than God's things. But listen to this. He says, therefore, thus saith the Lord of hosts, because you haven't heard my word, behold, I will send and take all the families of the north, your family, saith the Lord, and Nebuchadnezzar, that ruthless, wicked, evil king of Babylon, my servant, I'm using him for this cause now because I can use anyone, anywhere, anytime, any way I want to. Are y'all with me? Because God's still in control. Come on, my servant, and will bring them against this land and against the inhabitants thereof and against all these nations round about. He's going to gather them all up and will utterly destroy them and make them an astonishment and a hissing and perpetual desolation, a waste place. And moreover, I will take them from the voice of mirth, laughing. That means they're going to take their laughter. Now I know why everybody ain't smiling. Because how you going to be happy and you ain't hearing God in the midst of what's happening? We just said we already know everything going to work out for the good, even when it ain't good. So it take more muscles to frown than it do to smile, okay? Amen. You using a lot of energy to make that sad, frowny face on you. But I will take from them the voice of mirth. I will take from them the voice of gladness. Now, do you know why every time somebody come to you, they ain't got nothing good to say, always? And then you try to, here they come. Come on, let's get out of here. Come on, the voice of gladness, the voice of the bridegroom, the voice of the bride, the sound of millstones and the light of candle. And this whole land, are y'all still with me? This whole land will be a desolation and an astonishment. And these nations shall serve the king of Babylon, catch this one, 70 years. This is what Jeremiah is up here telling Cyrus. He started getting sad. But then it shall come to pass when 70 years are accomplished, that the same king, amen, that I allowed to hurt you, I'm going to turn around and hurt him. I'm going to punish the king of Babylon, and I'm going to punish that nation, saith the Lord, for their iniquity, for what they did to my people, and the land of the Chaldeans will be made, amen, will make it perpetual desolations, and I will bring upon that land all of my words which I have pronounced against it. You know what I promised them? I'm going to perform for them. Are y'all still with me? Even all that is written in this book, which Jeremiah prophesied against all the nations. He didn't stop there, though. Come on with me quickly. Flip over to chapter 29. Chapter 29 of Jeremiah, verse 10, for thus saith the Lord, that after these 70 years are accomplished at Babylon, I will visit you and perform, not a bad word, read it. I'm going to perform my good word toward you, and I'm going to cause you to return to the place that was taken from you. I just hear God. He may not be talking to everybody, but he's getting ready to restore and return somebody. Amen. I mean, some folk, anybody lost anything up in the house? Anything been taken, repossessed through here? Come on, God may be talking to you. It coming. It ought to stir you up. It coming back. It coming. Are y'all still with me? Amen. Come on. Because listen to what he says in verse 11. Because I know the thoughts that I think toward you, saith the Lord, and they're thoughts of peace. They're not thoughts of evil. I'm thinking about giving you an expected end. Because even though the beginning was horrific and the middle was horrifying, hold on to the end of the story because you're going to have a happy ending. Amen. Come on, I ain't talking to everybody, but anybody in the beginning, was it kind of humiliating the way life began? Come on, is it kind of hurting right here in the middle? God said, don't give up yet, because by the time you get to the end, what was humiliating and hurting, it's going to turn around and start making you happy about it. Now, you may not have to wait 5, 10 years. You might just have to wait till 6 o'clock this evening because your day didn't start out too good. It ain't looking too good right now. But can you trust God? By the time the sun go down, your blessing gonna come. Because he says, then you gonna call upon me and you shall go and pray unto me. And you know what? I'm gonna listen to you. Are y'all still there? He says, and you will seek me and find me when you shall search for me with all your heart. And I will be found of you, saith the Lord. And I will turn away what? Your captivity. I will gather you from all the nations and from all the places where I've driven you, saith the Lord. And I will bring you again into the place whence I caused you to be carried away. What? Captive. And he said, don't walk away, Cyrus. I got one more word from you. Isaiah chapter 45, the text we were in last week. Because Jeremiah, when he heard Jeremiah, he got stirred up. But when he heard Isaiah, he was off the chain. Because when he got to Isaiah 45, thus said the Lord to his anointed, to Cyrus. He heard his own name in the text. Whose right hand I'm holding, so he will be the one to subdue all these nations before him. And for him, I'm going to loose the loins of kings. I'm going to open before him the 2-leaved gates, and the gates shall not be shut on him. In fact, I'm going to go before him and make the crooked places straight. And I'm going to break in pieces the gates of brass and cut in sunder the bars of iron. And I'm going to give thee the treasures of darkness. Because Nebuchadnezzar, when he raided, amen, Jerusalem, he went in the temple and he stole all the gold and he took all the silver and everything, amen, that was worth of value. He took it and put it in his palace. Are y'all still there? And you know why I'm going to give it back to him? So that thou may knowest that I, the Lord, who called thee by your name before you were even named, even before you were named, because you didn't choose me, I chose you. Come on, y'all still ain't with me on this thing. No, I chose your name before your mama even knew the name. Come on. Which call thee by thy name, and the God of Israel, because Jacob, amen, my servant's sake, and Israel, mine elect, I have called thee by name, and I've surnamed thee. I even gave you a last name, though you don't even know me yet. And why would you say, though you don't know me yet? Because when God spoke these words about Cyrus, through Jeremiah and Isaiah, it was 200 years before Cyrus was born. 200 years before the boy was born. And God had already said what the income, outcome, and overcome of the story was going to be even before the story began. Can I tell you why God can do that? Look at your neighbor and say, because he's a shift stirrer. Amen. God's got a way of putting something together, and the something he puts together causes things to shift in your life where something just happens that ignites a favorable turnaround, and things that happen in your life, maybe not in your time, but in God's time, it's always on time. Okay, y'all ain't with me yet. So this is how the story goes, because I can't read the rest of it for you. But if you read in the book of Daniel, y'all, Daniel, you know, Daniel, amen, is when the Jews had been carried off to Babylon captivity. But when they were carried off into captivity, in this imprisonment and incarceration, God was still present in the situation. Okay, I got to preach to the lights, because just like God was with Paul and Silas in jail, and he was with Peter in jail. And when you read in Genesis, he was with Joseph when he was in jail. He went to jail with Daniel. He went to jail with Shadrach. He went to jail with, amen, Meshach. And he went to jail with that bad Negro we know as Abednego. Are y'all with me? Now, they was in jail, but if God's in jail with you, jail ain't like jail. Am I right about it? Because when you read Daniel's in the story, they found favor because the spirit of excellence was on them. Are y'all with me? When God began to exalt them above everybody else, not only in captivity, but even above their handlers. Are y'all with me? God provided for their need. They didn't have to eat the food that the other folk was eating. They said, we're going to eat just this fruit and vegetables and watch how God keep us healthy and strong. They said, we're going to trust in the Lord and watch how he keep us when we go in the lion's den. Watch how he keep us when we go in the fiery furnace. You know why? Because our God is not just for us. Our God is with us. Are y'all with me? And so Daniel had this spirit on him where he found favor with the king. Amen. Because he could interpret dreams and give prophecies about things not only that was happening, but some stuff that was getting ready to happen. Amen. So they were summoned for Daniel to come in. And Daniel said, if you want to know what's happening, because they didn't have these Bibles like you and I, they had them on scrolls. Look at your neighbor, say they had them on scrolls. Amen. And so here come Daniel into the presence of the king Cyrus of Persia, and he rolls out his scroll. And y'all know what he read. I just read it for you. He starts reading about what Jeremiah said, how that the people of God was going to go into captivity. Are y'all with me? And how they were going to stay there 70 years. Amen. But then when he rolled out the scroll of Isaiah, and he said, there is going to be a man named Cyrus who is going to sit on the throne as the king of Persia. And he going to be the one that God uses to loose and set his people go. Amen. And amen. Cyrus didn't understand it, but Daniel looked at him and said, you know what, king? I think the Lord is talking about you. Amen. And when he figured out the Lord was talking about him, Ezra wrote it down and said it stirred him up, y'all. Come on here. I don't know if you ever hear God talking about you healed, but if you sick and he say you healed, you ought to get a little stirred up. Am I right? I know you came in here broke, but if God said you ain't leaving broke, don't sit there frozen. You ought to get a little stirred up. Am I right about it? Come on, if God says I'm going to supply even more than you need, and you came in here, you ain't even got change for a nickel, amen, tell your neighbor it ought to stir you up, amen. I know they cuss you out walking in the door, but they going to hug you coming back in the door, God said. Tell your neighbor it should stir you up, amen. I know you clocked out of hell on Friday, but God says trust him and you'll clock back into heaven on Monday, amen. Tell your neighbor, don't sit there like that. Shake a little bit. Wave your hand. Open your mouth. Say, thank you, Jesus, amen. Because if you hear the word receiving, tell your neighbor, it ought to stir you up, because God ain't talking about everybody. He talking about you. Talking about you, the incarcerated one, the imprisoned one, the one who's in jail and ain't in jail, the one who's in prison. And look around, you ain't really in prison, but don't life feel like prison? You got a situation got you prison. circumstance, condition, family trouble in prison, health trouble in prison, financial trouble in prison. Come on, employment, job trouble. Y'all, I'm talking to you right now. Yeah, in prison, amen. But God says there's a set time to get you out of prison. I've set a time for your liberation to come out of your incarceration. Y'all know the process, right? Come on, he says, I'm going to do some excavation first. And excavation is when you know you dig to get it out of. There's some stuff you stuck in, but God's going to excavate you. Look at your neighbor and say, he's going to get you out of it, amen. And when he gets you out of it, he's going to emancipate you. He's going to free you from it, amen. And when he frees you from it, he's going to do some elimination. He's going to rid and remove it, not just from your life. He's going to rid and remove it from your family. He's going to rid and remove it from your children. In fact, you haven't even met your grandchildren and your great-grandchildren. But what affected granddaddy and grandmama, mama and daddy, the buck stops here. Are y'all with me? Because through elimination, look at your neighbor and say, God's rid and removing that thing. But tell you, he ain't stopped yet, amen, because then there's eradication, amen. And an eradication, what was bothering you, what was burdening you, what was bugging you, first of all, God wipes it out, amen. He wipes out all of your enemies. He wipes out all of your troubles. He wipes out all of your heartaches. Y'all ain't feeling me. He wipes out all of your pain, but he don't just wipe it out. With the blood of Jesus, he washes it out. Amen. And when he washes it out, when folk look at you, they don't realize what you've been going through, because you don't look no longer like what you've been going through, because what God has done for you, amen. How can God do elimination, eradication, amen, excavation in my life? Tell your neighbor, he's a shift stirrer, amen. He can take the good with the bad. He can take the happy with the sad. He can take the down with the up and stir it all together and work it out. For your Cyrus heard this and he started jumping. I got to get up out of here, but look at this, amen. Cyrus, when he hears this word, Cyrus mounted up his soldiers. Amen. They came in a huddle and got their strategy and game plan together. And he said, this is what we're going to do. We're going to go down here and read it in Daniel, where the river Euphrates has been flowing into the Jordan River. We're going to divert the river and detour it. Now that instead of running to the Jordan, it's going to run into the swamp. And now that the water ain't coming down to the Jordan from the Euphrates, it's going to be easier for us to cross on over into Babylon. Y'all ain't felt me yet. He said, now we might have a little problem, because the way I see it, even though we cross over this dry riverbed, there are gates that are locked with brass and iron. But amazingly, because we saw this with Peter, when God let him out of prison, he thought he was going to have to jimmy the gate or turn back around. But when he said, in the name of Jesus, the gate just opened up, amen. And that, if you read the story, that's what happened to Cyrus. They crossed across the riverbed, and when they got to the gate, the bars had already been broken. The chains had already been removed. You know why? Because God had already prophesied 200 years before, I'm going to break the lock that had you bound, amen. I'm going to break the chain that was holding you out, holding you up, not letting you get into your blessing. Y'all ain't felt me yet. You know the one, amen, you've been wanting to get out of that house into the other one, and some of them been holding you up, amen. You know the school you've been trying to get your child on, and the waiting list is 5 years long. Come on here, y'all ain't felt me yet. You know, amen, the doctor, amen, keep giving you more pills and more medicine, but God says, I'm getting ready to break that chain. I'm getting ready to destroy that lock. By the time you get to that place, it will be already. He stirred him up. And so here they go marching through the town. They come to the gate and it's all open. And they can hear music. Da, 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 da. A party's going on. Because when you read Daniel, they was having a big time party. Are y'all with me? Amen. The booze was flowing, the music was playing, and they just was gone.
In fact, it got so high and drunk, somebody said, look over there, King. He said, look where? Over there. And when he looked over there, a hand without a body was writing on the wall. You know you high then, huh? All you see is the hand. And he was like, Lord, because it was being written in something he didn't understand. And they needed the interpreter to come in. And when they read what it said, tonight, King, is your last night. You are finished. You are through. And you are done. And by the time they read it, here comes Cyrus and his soldiers through the room. They raid the palace. Are y'all with me? They take Nebuchadnezzar and all of his people captive. They get all of God's stuff out of his house. Are y'all with me? And they take over Babylon. Are y'all still with me? Just like God said they would do. Are you still there? And then when we get into Ezra, that's why the text says, when Ezra heard the words of Jeremiah, you can put Isaiah, this is what stirred up. Come on, come on back with me. This is what stirred up his spirit, amen, because the Lord had already told him, you're going to subdue all the nations. He had already told him, you were going to loose the loins, take away the strength and power of the kings, amen. He said he told him, you were going to take back what had been taken from my people, and you would be the instrument. Y'all ain't shouting with me. You would be the vessel, amen, that would give my people they stuff back, amen. And so when Cyrus hears this word, he sits down and he gets a pen out. Are you in Ezra? And he makes out this proclamation throughout all his kingdom, and he put it in writing and said, Cyrus, verse 2, king of Persia, who is a man, the Lord God of heaven have given me all the kingdoms of the earth. I fought them, I whipped them, I defeated them, destroyed them. Are y'all with me? He said, and now he has charged me to build him a house at Jerusalem. The where in Judea, amen. He says, so where is the people among you of all of his people? He says, I'm looking for the folk who are still holding on, amen. You know, because they had a horrible beginning. They had a horrific middle, but I sent a word, told them, don't get weary in well doing, because if you hold on, you're going to reap. Huh? If you faint not, amen. And when you look around for some of us done given up, amen. Come on, some of us done given out. Y'all ain't shouting with me. Some of y'all got discouraged, and some of them went and joined another church, amen. But you ought to look at your neighbor and say, I'm still holding on, baby. I'm still holding on, amen. Because the race ain't given to the swift. Oh, I feel good now. The amen. Battle ain't given to the strongest one. Come on, you know who it is. It's given to the one who endures. Come on, to the end, amen. Weeping may endure for a night. But if you hold on, you ought to tell your neighbor what joy. Come on, joy will come in the morning, amen. Because when I read this word, can I tell you, amen, the word, amen, this now next word, amen, that God gives unto us, amen, it's not just a relevant word. It's not just a real word. Come on, look at somebody and say, this is a rhema word, y'all. Because God stirred some things up, amen. And when he stirred them up, something happened, amen, that what ignited favorable turnaround in the lives of who? Tell your neighbor, God's people, amen. And when he turned it around, amen, because many of us, we've been seeing things. Come on, we've been hearing things. Come on, we've been through some things. Some things have been done to us, and some things have been done for us, amen. But now, amen, what we're facing, now what we're dealing with and going through, come on, tell your neighbor, God is up to something. Come on, you all, okay? I shouted to myself. I said, God is up to something. You wonder why folk who ain't acting funny now? Because God is up to something, amen. You wonder why folk hating on you and ain't congratulating you? Tell your neighbor, because God is up to something, amen. You know why God allows some folk to write you off and cross you off and kick you to the curb, amen? You ought to look at somebody and say, God is up to something, amen. You know why, amen, things ain't going like this and ain't happening. happening like that, you better tell your neighbor. Say, neighbor, God is up to something. You know what he's up to, right? Tell your neighbor, he's stirring up some shift, amen. He's stirring up something to happen, whoa, that will ignite a favorable turnaround in your life, in your family, in your home, in your finances. Lay your hands on yourself. He's stirring up some shift in your health right now. In the name of Jesus, amen. Because I see now a little clearer now what Andre Crouch was saying. He says you don't get down and you don't get depressed and disappointed because things ain't going right. Remember somebody, Andre said, you got to learn how to thank God for your mountains. But you also got to learn how to thank God when you're down in your valleys. You got to learn. Look at somebody, say, you got to learn how to thank God whatever you're going through. Because if you never had a problem, you wouldn't know God the shift stirrer. He could solve them, amen. You wouldn't know what your faith in God could really do, amen. You ought to get up, put your hand on your hip and just say, through it all, amen. Through all the ups and downs, amen. Through all the good and the bad. Through all the sunshine and rain. Through all my happiness and pain. Through folk liking me and disliking me. Through folk patting me on the back and others stabbing me in the back. Through it all, amen. I've learned I can trust in Jesus. Come on, through it all, y'all. I've learned I can trust in God. I would fist pump somebody here and say, through it all, I've learned I can depend on his word, amen. Because the word is what woke me up this morning. The word is what started me on my way. The word is what's leading me through the day. I said, after I hear it, after I receive the word, after I believe and do it, my life ain't gonna be the same. Tell your neighbor, the word is bringing me out of darkness, bringing me into the light. The word, amen, bringing me out of sickness, bringing me into health, amen. Nothing but the word, y'all. It ought to stir you up because it's bringing you out of poverty. It'll bring you into wealth. The word, amen. Can you yell the word? The word, amen. It'll get you out of defeat and plant your feet in victory. Come on, take a stand and say, victory is mine. Victory is mine. I told Satan, you got to get behind me because victory in my home, in my family, in my finances, in my health, in my wealth, it's mine, it's mine. He said it. I believe it and I receive it in Jesus' name. Oh, you better chew it with me. I said, he said it. I read it. So I believe it and I receive it in Jesus' name. I got to seal it because the devil want to steal it. But I heard him say it. And what he said, I read. And what I read, I believed it. And because I believed it, look at three folks say, I receive it. I receive it. I receive my healing. I receive my deliverance. I receive my breakthrough. I receive my turnaround. I receive my change. I receive my family coming back together again. I receive it. God's a shift stirrer. God's a shift stirrer, y'all. God will stir up something that will happen, that will ignite favorable. Come on, let it out your mouth, favorable. So many of us been going through unfavorable. Come on, unfavorable. Some of us have been experienced disfavorable, but favorable. Things are working together for your good. Favorable. Things are coming together for your good. Favorable. Things are not getting worse. They're getting better. Amen. Favor. Somebody's sitting there saying, why though? Why the problem? Y'all sit down. Let me tell this story I heard the other day. Why the trouble? Why the pain? Because God's ready to show you another side of him. You ain't never seen before. You've seen him down on this level. And this is the only level you think he can work on. But he God of everything. He God of every level. Same God that did the little thing, he can do the big thing. Same God that gave you that can also release this. The same God that helped you yesterday, same God, same God. Hear the story. This lady, she had invited to come to church. And when she came to church, she started liking church, so she came back. She came back again. She enjoyed the preacher. She enjoyed the choir. She fell in love with the members. She came back again. Then one Sunday, Josh, the invitation was extended, and she came down the aisle and committed and connected to that church. And she didn't soon just become a good member. She became a faithful member. Found out her place in the ministry. Found out her part, what she was called to do in the ministry. And she was faithful to doing it. And one night, about this time of year, Thanksgiving, Christmas shopping going on, she went out shopping at the mall. And she didn't know, amen, that the devil had her on surveillance. Because when she wasn't bothering him, he wasn't bothering her. But now she done found a church. She done committed and connected to. And now she bothering the devil. And so he got to stop her by bothering her. So he's under surveillance and got these hoodlum thugs walking behind her, following her. She do all her shopping and get it all together. She getting ready to go out to her car, Lady Regina. And the thugs jump her, snatch her, throw her into their van, wrap her up in duct tape, wrap her eyes, her mouth, wrap up her hands and legs. She can't move. And she can hear them talking about raping her and killing her. Amen. And doing all kind of crazy things. And she starts saying, God, what's up with this? She said, when I was out there in the world, I didn't have no problems. I didn't have no troubles. And I went over to that church to stop, and the pastor was telling me that things were shifting for my better. And now look at it, it's done shift for my worse. How could you let this happen to me? But all of a sudden, they hit the brakes. Oh, she could hear the sliding door of the van open up. And they just kicked her out the van. She rolled down the hill into a ditch, and she could hear the tires screeching off, and they gone. And now she done rolled down in this ditch, and she can feel the bugs crawling on her. She can feel the ants crawling on her, and can't do a thing about it. But then all of a sudden, Diane, it started raining. In fact, it started storming. And now she's saying, I really can't believe this, God. You done got let me get mugged. You done let me get all tied up in this duct tape. And now I'm fell in this ditch and all these bugs and ants is crawling on me. And who knows what else is getting ready to happen. And now, to make it worse, you letting it rain. But all of a sudden, she was able to move her head. And she was able to move her arms. And then she was able to move her legs. Because when the rain fell, it loosened up the duct tape. That she was able to peel the tape off and get out of it, walk back up to the road and find some help. And by the time she got up there, here come a highway patrol by and picks her up. Takes her to the highway patrol office, amen. Without a scratch, without a bruise, without a cut. Are y'all with me? Just a little glue on her that they wipe off and wash off. Y'all ain't feeling me yet. And if nobody told you, you wouldn't understand what she had been going through, amen. Because she didn't look like none of it. But when she told the story, she said, you know what? God had to send a storm in my life to deliver me out of my troubles, amen. And I'm just trying to let somebody know who's in a storm right now. I just need to let somebody know who's dealing with a problem and trouble, and it look like you finishing you through. Tell your neighbor, ain't nothing but a test, that God's going to turn around for your testimony. I need you to get up and hug about three folk and just encourage them and tell them, hang on in there. Come on, just hug somebody. Tell them, hang on in there. Don't you give up. Hang on in there. Don't you give in. Hang on in there. Don't you throw in the towel. Hang on in there. Don't you quit. You're not finished. You're not done. You're not through, amen. Hang on. God is up to something. 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 Get ready. Get ready for your miracle. Come on, tell somebody. Oh, God is up to something. God is up to something. Oh, God is up to something. God is up to something. So get ready. Get ready for your miracle. Well, God is up to something. I said, God is up to something. Oh, God is up to something. I said, God is up to something. So get ready. 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 Get ready for your miracle. Oh, I said, God is up to something. How many believe God is up to something? I said, God is up to something. Oh, God is up to something. So I'm ready. I'm ready. I'm ready. I'm ready. Are you ready? Are you ready for your miracle? Come on, everybody on their feet, heads are bowed, eyes are closed, heads are bowed, eyes are closed. 200 years before time, God had already been ready to move and show up on time. Before trouble became trouble, God knew it was going to be trouble. Before the problem became a problem, God knew it was going to be a problem. Before that situation turned and developed into a situation, God already knew there was going to be a situation coming. And he told me to tell you, if there was a way in that thing, he got a way out of that thing. And while you're in the midst of in the thing and looking to get out of the thing, he got a way for you to get over the thing, over the hurt, over the pain, over the trouble, over the disappointment, over the discouragement, because God know how to stir it all up. I said, God know how to stir it all up. And why does he do it like that? He God. He can do what he want, when he want, how he want to whoever he want. Hear Jesus in John 15 again, you didn't choose me. I chose you. I ordained you so I can get fruit out of you. And fruit ain't always produced in the light like it is in the dark. Fruit ain't always produced in good times. Sometimes it's developed in bad times. Fruit, amen, what made you better wasn't a lot of folk liking you. It was when a lot of folk were hating on you. What opened up that door, God had to shut that window. And you thought your life was over because he shut a window. But as soon as he shut the window, that's when he opened up the door. Somebody didn't realize God allowed your body to get sick so your soul could get well. If he just would have healed your body and you would have got up and started running on, you would have ran back to where you ran from. But when you couldn't get up, you didn't look for none of your friends. You didn't look for none of your boom coons and buddies. You start calling out to God, help me, Lord, help me, Lord. I'll serve you, Lord. I'll praise you, Lord. I'll live for you. And God didn't just heal your body. God healed your soul. Somebody knew before God could build it up, he had to allow it to be torn down. But it was all for our good. I'm going to say it again. It was all for our, because it drew us closer to the Lord. Are y'all with me? And we developed a closer relationship with him. Not just a 2-hour Sunday thing, but an everyday all thing. God is up to something. God is up to something. In the midst of the pain, in the midst of the tragedy, in the midst of the trouble, in the midst of the heartache, in the midst of the pain, God is up to something. And the something he's up to, it's for your good. Heads are bowed, eyes are closed. Saints are praying in case one is some in the house. First of all, you're not saved. You don't have a right relationship with the Lord. You don't have a right relationship. Because a right relationship with the Lord, you don't just say he's God and he's Lord. And he say, no, you confess him as my God, my Lord, my Savior. Simple as A, B, and C. A, I asked him. B, I believed in him. C, I just called and confessed. And when I did the A, B, C, he did the D. What is the D? He did the rest after I asked. Save me, Lord, after I believed he was, after I called on him, because whoever calls upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. Not just right now from a hell you can go through, but from now on from a hell you can go to. No matter who you are, what you've done, where you come from, if you just ask, if you just believe and call on him right here, right now, he will receive you. But I'm too dirty, I'm too crooked, I'm too broken, I'm too down. Well, other folk came just like that. Ain't no perfect folk in here right now, and we working on that thing with the help of God. But somebody will tell you when they came to the Lord, they were dirty, and he started to help clean them up. They were crooked, and he started to help straighten them up. They were broken, and he started fixing them back up. If they tell you the truth, some of them tell you, when I came to the Lord, I was down. But he started helping and lifting me back up. And what the Lord has done for others, ask him. Believe and call on him. Watch what he do for you. Watch what he do for you. Some of y'all have a right relationship, but are you connected to the church? The church is not just a building and a place. The church is a people. And in that place, through those people, God helps people to help people. That's what the church does, a real church. They will get help, but they will be help. God will better their lives to help better other folks. God will benefit people so they can help benefit others. God will bless them. And you have to commit. Because if you don't commit to the church, it's like going to school and not, amen, getting your lesson. It's like going to the gym and not working out, just sitting up in the gym and wondering why your muscles ain't getting stronger and tighter and bigger. Talk to me, somebody. No, if your muscles gonna get better, you get bigger at the gym, you gotta commit. Same thing at church. If you gonna get better at church, you got to commit. And God's calling you to a commitment to him and his church. You hear this word today, isn't it an eye-opening word that, amen, amen, that troubles, heartaches, and pains come with the territory? Struggles, amen, challenges. But some way, somehow, God will intervene to help you with you. He will help you with you to be the you he called you to be. So many of us are praying to God, change people, change places, change things. God told me to tell you, he might not change no people for you. He might not change no places. They're going to stay like that or get worse. Some things ain't going to get better. But you know what he said? Even though I don't change the people, the places, and things for you, I'm going to change you for the people, places, and things. You're going to have a new attitude. You're going to have a new way of looking and saying. You're going to have a new way of living. Because the Spirit of God will take hold and control of your life to enable you to do what Paul said, all things through him. Because he will strengthen you to be that kind of woman, to be that kind of man, to be that kind of mother, that kind. He ain't calling you to be any and everybody. He's calling you to be somebody. Any of us can be anybody. God don't want us to be anybody. He wants us to be the somebody that he called us to be. And God will help you. And then prayer. Because we got to go. Prayer. Somebody needs divine direction leaving this place today. You need your steps to be ordered by the Lord so that the devil does not detour you. He does not distract you and get you off of the path that God has already laid and paved for you. Amen. It ain't that you're a bad person. Just sometimes I give in to bad things. Sometimes it ain't that I'm a wrong person. I just sometimes am led the wrong way. Let God lead you and you won't go wrong. Let God direct you and you won't go wrong. You won't be getting down the road talking about something told me not to do this. Something told me not to write my name on that paper. Something told me not to. That ain't something. That's somebody. That's the Holy Spirit. Leading, guiding, and directing so the Lord can protect you. Lift your head. Open your eyes today. Somebody else. I feel you out there. Somebody else. Yeah. Yeah, there they go. Come on. Bring them on down. Come on, Anthony. Amen. Somebody else, it ain't too late. You better come on. He ain't asked you to confess nothing. He ain't asked you to explain nothing. Just one word, come. That will change the environment and atmosphere of your life. Because if you just sit there, yeah, God does see your need. But take a step of faith and watch how he's able to supply even more than you need. He's a shift stirrer, y'all. Stir it up so something will happen to ignite a favorable. Anybody need a favorable turnaround in your life? Y'all in order to stretch your hands this way in just a simple prayer. Lord, supply those people every need. Can you stretch your hand this way and just pray that prayer? Lord, supply those people. Yeah. Pray for them now because you might be up here next. And sow that seed that you pray for somebody and they now so that God will touch somebody when you get into your next. Those of y'all up here now, pray for yourself, but pray for the one next to you. You may not even know them or know why they down here. Just say, Lord, do for my sister what I'm asking you to do for me. God, bless my brother like I'm praying you bless me. If you want to be saved, if you want to be healed and delivered, you need help in your life, your family, your home. Just ask God to do for them what you're asking him to do for you. And that way, two or three of us will be touching and agreeing on the same thing. And God, amen, he said, if you do that, I'll be in your midst. And I won't just hear y'all. I will help y'all. Father, in Jesus' name, we thank you and we praise you for these who have come. Before they came, you knew the need of their life. Now they have come. Your desire is to supply even more than they need through the help of the Holy Spirit, the Word of God, the church, and believers. Grow them in grace and in the knowledge of you. Place a hedge of protection around them, God, that the enemy of this world will not steal, kill, nor destroy as you prosper and increase these people day after day and time after time after time. This is only the beginning, because we come to you, God, as we are. But if we connect and commit to you, we won't stay as we are, because you got so much more in store. You have so much more in store. And so we say thank you for it all in Jesus' name. We pray, praise, and prevail. Let the people of God say amen. Amen, amen. Come on, y'all hug each other before you leave and just tell them, neighbor, God's up to something. Come on, bro. Don't be left out. God up to something, brother. Come on, everybody. Give God a hand of praise. Give God a big hand of praise. Hallelujah. God can stir it up, y'all. Amen, Pastor Green. I said, God can stir it up. That something will happen that will ignite and influence a favorable turnaround. Favorable things in the lives of God's people. Come on, can you put your hands together for the Lord today? Can you put your hands together?